I'm going to take advantage being the moderator. So I'm going to a question for both Donald and Kingsley. Now, Donald, you left us with an image of a football team, the selection of the players, and there's no exclusion there. And can you just sort of relate that to, you know, the rest of Africa outside of the football stadium? Why is it that you can have, clearly you have the capability of being very inclusive because you got to win, you have to compete, and yet the same capability is not translated elsewhere?
Yeah, I really have to be honest with you. Over years of observing what happened in Africa in 54 countries, I'm persuaded beyond any reasonable doubt that inclusion begins with political participation. You could have all the perfect technical solutions, but until every citizen believes he, she has a stake in the system, it's simply not possible. So this is what I said at the World Economic Forum meeting in Addis. I think Kofi Annan was chairing the meeting, and he was asked, if there was one thing, only one thing you would do to promote inclusion, what would you do? And I said, get the children of very poor families into high quality education. Because in that way, you cut once and for all the intergenerational distribution of poverty. Mm. It means children don't have to inherit the conditions of their parents or grandparents. Now, I've watched the three countries in Africa which have got this right. They happen to miss more islands, unfortunately, all of them. Mauritius, Cape Verde, and Seychelles. And all boils down to education. So I agree with you. Education is not enough on its own. But believe me, I do not know a single country which had given opportunity to all its children, including those from the favelas, into high quality education and got it wrong. Now, that may mean using social protection, conditional cash transfers. That's right. That may mean public policy influencing composition of expenditures in some way. But this is the only thing I found. Now, it can only happen if those in political power agree that all tribes, all regions, all genders have the same rights. But if those in power don't believe so, it won't happen. You would have the best technical solutions, but it will not happen. So for me, I am persuaded that it begins by ensuring that the political systems represent everyone, what I call a stakeholder economy. Then you can bring the technical solutions in place.
Kingsley.
But if you want, just look at South Africa. Look at South Africa, the most unequal country in Africa. Gini coefficient, I think, about 7 or 8. Mm-hmm. Regarding marriage, 7 or 8, that about. But what is it? Just look at its history. It decided a certain category of population did not deserve the same education as the others, all right? And so now, the labor market is completely, it's dysfunctional. Because for a long time, the political system decided to have some people educated and others low quality education. It's not that they lack the technical knowledge. They simply decided politically a category of population did not deserve that quality of education. That is all.
Mm-hmm. Kingsley, your take.
Well, thank you. I agree with Donald. What I'm going to add is the role of culture and cultural dynamism and the evolution of cultures in promoting inclusive growth. Let me explain. In the northern part of Nigeria, there is a social and cultural system that has held education down. This system is feudalistic, and it creates emirs, royalty, and the people congregate at the feet of that royalty. They listen to what the royalty tells them. They do whatever the royalty tells them. And some people in the north have developed in the past a vested interest in keeping the system so. They base it, quote unquote, whether that's true or not, on religion and their culture in order to maintain their power in the northern part of the country and in the larger Nigerian nation. Therefore, addressing these cultural issues, which affect the way people think, is very important. Now, that determines whether women can go to school. That determines whether very poor people can go to school. So culture, everything is rooted in many African countries in the cultural context. And if you get people to understand that culture is dynamic, this culture is not working for our development. Mm-hmm. If it's not working, if it's making us poor, we need to change this culture. We need to move away from it. Once you do this, I think you'll begin to break the back of inclusion and then get to the point, what Donald is talking about, of education. So I just wanted to add that mm-hmm. to the fact of education and political inclusion. Mm-hmm. This is peculiar to certain communities, not necessarily to every community in the continent or in every country, but it's a powerful factor.
A very good example of how culture actually can be harnessed for positive change, dynamic change, is India. Today, the poorest quintiles of households by income are actually sending the children to private schools. But the public school's quality is known to be very, very bad, and in the past, it's only the elite, you know, would spend money, send the children and girls to private schools. And now the poorest households are doing so. And it turns out it's clearly there's a return to that investment. But more importantly is that religion, culture, is a very multifaceted, fluid concept. So sure enough, some NGOs in India found that somewhere in the Ramayana, there's a Shiva talk about how wonderful it is to train your girls well. Yeah. So that has been used, you know, to encourage educating girls and educating the children.
Absolutely.
And this is among the poorest of the households. You know, so I don't see that as a sort of deterministic factor, but it's how it can be used, right, for positive change. So in and of itself, I think it becomes entrenched as a barrier to inclusion when all the other forces work in a mutually reinforcing way. That's you send your kids to school, but there's no return. They still cannot find jobs and so on. But if you know the dynamic turns the other way, culture, I don't think is a sort of unmovable barrier.
But can I say something, by the way, about this? I've heard people say that if you educate children and they find no jobs, that is a wasted investment. I disagree.
No. Mm-hmm.
Totally disagree.
Okay, explain.
I am prepared to invest in education, even if at the end of it, a job takes time to come about. Because as Amartya Sen put it, what is the purpose of development? The purpose of development is freedom.
Yeah.
To make all these choices which are available in the economic space. And so to have people locked in ignorance, not able to read and write, to access the internet, is the lack of freedom 100% over. So I do believe that providing education to all our children, especially those from the poor parts of the countries, poor families, disadvantaged, even if at the end of the day we have to struggle to get jobs for them, it is something worth doing. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Question?
Ricardo.
Yeah, 1, 2, 3. So 1, 2, 3.
That's a fascinating panel. Thank you. I wanted to ask the panel. We're talking about sub-Saharan Africa, say, you know, countries where average income is around, say, $1,000 of income per capita. Tax revenues on a good day, maybe 15% of GDP. So that's like $150 per capita of public spending that you could potentially allocate. Electricity penetration is very low. Water systems are very limited. Road systems are very limited. School systems are very limited. What is the, how do you think about, I mean, by the way, roads and dams and power plants are not green, so not necessarily very favored by the international aid agencies, while, you know, nicer feeling things like conditional cash transfers might be more favored. By the way, conditional cash transfers were developed in Mexico, which was a country, I don't know, $10,000 of income per capita, targeting, you know, and collecting 20% of GDP in taxes, so having $2,000 to spend per capita, and to send it to a small fraction of the population that was poor. So in that context, what is, does inclusive growth in sub-Saharan Africa go by connecting people to basic infrastructure, or does it go by conditional cash transfers?
I don't know what Kingsley would say, but I'll go back to Ricardo. Yesterday I was telling you, teasing you and Marcella, that, about this Warren Buffett's famous saying, that you don't know who is swimming naked until the tide is out of the way. So let's assume the tide is off. So oil prices have gone down, copper prices. What you'll find is that the typical narrative about Africa is misplaced. It is a continent which has changed beyond recognition.
That's true.
And believe me, I've visited all the 54 countries. They still have challenges of infrastructure, social and economic. They still have dependence on commodities. But something has happened on the ground. And my sense of it is that it boils down to what I said before, education. And so you can build all these roads. In Somalia, people build the roads. The African Development Bank invested a lot there, all right? But because of what happened in the political space, everything has been destroyed. So you can build the roads, the railways, the ports. What destroyed Somalia was that the dictator who was in place decided that a part of the country was to be excluded. So civil war began, and 25 years down the road, the infrastructure has been destroyed. So I'll go back to the point I made too. It's not about the roads, the highways, the oil. It's about political participation. It's about political systems that allow people to prosper, all parts of the country, all races, all tribes, all religions. But now coming to the story of Sub-Saharan Africa, I think Kingsley was mentioning that economic growth and economic transformation are different things. Economies have grown roughly ballpark number between 2000 and now, the economic size is up almost five times. Now, that is not something to be ignored, and it is not simply in the countries with oil and gas. The fastest growing countries have been Ethiopia, it has been Kenya, it has been Cote d'Ivoire, the entire East African space, where you have no gas, you have no oil, you have no minerals. And you can ascribe that to three things. Regional trade, and sophisticated products for sure, but regional trade, which is around 27% in the South African political space, almost the same in the ASEAN region. Number two, domestic demand, because of fast urbanization. In that region, almost 48% of the people now live in the urban areas. And thirdly, let's give praise what is due, decades of macroeconomic reforms, which have made these economies very stable. You could see during the financial crisis, the banks were well capitalized, everything was fine, compared at least to some countries in the north. So I do think the narrative about Sub-Saharan Africa, which treats the continent as an outlier, is a bit outdated. Mm-hmm. You have a few islands of instability or problems, but I do believe that things are happening on the ground. Transformation is very slow, but it's taking place.
Kingsley, would you like to add anything?
Oh, yes. I do agree with Donald. I mean, the African continent has changed quite significantly. No question about it. It's just that some of us are a little bit more impatient about the pace of growth and the nature of the growth. And this brings me to the comment I wanted to make about our political leadership. Many of the political leaders in the continent, some understand the right things to do, but some do not. And so I think if they know the right things and how to do the right things, many of them will do those things. Right. So I think engaging with the political leadership with some sort of policy advice is very, very important.
I think that's the next task for the CID. Thank you very much. Yeah. Time's up.
Yeah.